Testing 1, 2. Well, good morning, everybody. It is a good morning. I think we've made it through our big hot heat wave. We're going to have nice days for the next few weeks, but it might not be 100 and something. We're not used to that. Maybe like Donna, who back in Louisiana used to some hotter heat. Well, it's hot out here the last couple days, but I'm so glad to be in here. And we have air conditioning in here, and we have such a nice looking crowd here today. How wonderful to see everybody today. Well, we're going to start out with worship. We have a really nice service planned for you today, and we're going to be talking about the judgment seat of Christ, what we got to look forward to one day. We'll be talking about that. But we're going to start with a worship song right now. Would you stand together with us as we sing Only a God Like You? Here we go. We turn this service over to you right now. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Praise God. You may be seated, everybody. I have some announcements.
Oh, I don't have too many announcements, but I got some good ones, though. Hey, praise the Lord.
Yes.
Welcome to Riverside Church. It's good to see some new faces. It's good to see some old ones, too. And look at this new baby. We have a new baby, first time here. Her name is Eden. It's so cool. We're going to have an awesome baby dedication. We're going to dedicate that baby to the Lord Jesus officially next Sunday. So we'll see what our baby dedications are like. And we always like to dedicate our firstborn children to the Lord. Well, no, all our children to the Lord. Right? Yeah. Otherwise, I wouldn't be. Okay, that's not that funny. But anyway, here's an announcement. It's hot! Right? And it's hard to think when it's hot out. Right? Yeah, obviously. But we had a really good breakfast, didn't we? Praise the Lord. Isn't that amazing how they can get that going and get that out? And all the volunteers and everything. And the bulletin, isn't the bulletin look nice this morning? Really pretty. Did everybody get a bulletin? I'd like to make sure everybody... Just go give them one. And you need one too?
You just stop right there.
Here.
Stop and take that way.
Alright. Ladies first, that's right. So maybe there's anyone out there. Okay. Well. Anyway, so I just want to say we're having a baptism today. My little girl, all on her own decision, her own idea, wants to be baptized. And I keep saying, we're going to do it next week, we're going to do it next week. And finally, it's here. We're doing it today. And there she is, my little Olive right back there. She's getting baptized. And she's giving her life to Jesus. And you can ask her yourself. And so just praise the Lord. So that's going to be after the service. Let's just worship the Lord, our God, with all our heart, all our mind, and all our strength this morning together. And let's just enjoy His love and His Spirit this morning. Are you guys ready to worship the Lord and put all your focus, yes. Put your eyes on Jesus? You ready to put your hands on Jesus?
Amen.
You ready to put your feet on Jesus? Are you ready to stand up for Jesus or sing for Jesus or just do anything for Jesus?
Let's do it.
We kind of like, whatever we do in the name of the Lord Jesus.
Amen.
That's the way I think. I think that's the way most of us think here too. So anyway, let's just worship the Lord all together. Here, let's have a reading of Scripture. Thank you.
First Corinthians chapter 2, verses 6 through 10. Howbeit we speak wisdom among them that are perfect, yet not the wisdom of this world, nor the princes of this world that come to naught. But we speak the wisdom of God in a mystery, even the hidden wisdom which God ordained before the world unto our glory, which none of the princes of this world knew. For had they known it, they would not have crucified the Lord of glory. But as it is written, eye hath not seen, nor ear heard, neither have entered into the heart of man the things which God hath prepared for them that love him. But God hath revealed them unto us by his Spirit. For the Spirit searcheth all things, yea, the deep things of God. 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verses 6 through 10.
Believe it or not, that pertains to the message today about the judgment seat of Christ. We're going to be looking about what the Lord will be looking at when we stand before him. And we'll be talking about that in a little bit. Stuff. So we're going to continue to worship a little bit more right now. So if we can stand together, we're going to sing one called I'll Fly Away. Here we go.
Fly away like a bird.
It's all called Come to Jesus right now. He's calling on us, waiting for us to come, singing.
We came wounded sinner, lost and left to die. Raise your hand for love that's passing by. Come to Jesus.
I'm so thankful for all the things that you're doing and all the things that you're working out in our lives, Lord. I see so many different things and so many different areas how you're working, and I'm so thankful to have grown to the point where I am not so impatient at watching you work, Lord, and I'm just so thankful for all the things you do. I'm thankful for people that you've sent, and I'm just thankful for how you work, Lord. I just have so much to be thankful for. And I'm thankful that we can come together and pray And what power we have in numbers when we're all on the same page, holding certain ones up. And we see the world is so afflicted, Lord, and there's so many needs out there that there could be nothing more important than having us all together and praying together as you see us praying and interceding. It's so important. One of the things that the throne judgment that you'll be seeing is all the prayers that we prayed. Lord, I just pray that you would just hold up today, especially those people in Louisiana who are struggling. And we know that Don and Donna know some people there. Their grandkids are there too. And they were so lucky to flee out of there. And I know God was working in their life to have a doctor's appointment to come up here and get it canceled just to get you away from there. But Lord, I just am so thankful that they're here, and I'm so thankful for how you work. And I just pray, Lord, that you would just touch the lives of all those people in Louisiana and help them through these things, to seeing how high that water is and all the devastation and the hurt hearts and the people that have struggled so much there, Lord. I pray that you would just make a revival there. And as they work through their trials, you send trials so we would seek you. I pray that there's a massive revival in the hearts of the people there that would know to seek you with every part of their being. So, Lord, I pray that you would bless them, help them. Help them to grow and help them to heal. Help them to repair what's gone on. Also, Lord, we want to hold up David, who is not with us today, who is, he fell. And he's got cerebral palsy, and he's been struggling. But we love him so much, Lord, and he's such a wonderful Christian. I pray that you would just bless him, touch his life, Lord. Help him through this trial right now and help him. We just thank you for David, and I just know that you're working in his life. He is a blessing and a testimony to you. Also, Lord, we want to hold up Amber, who has been experiencing these blisters in her mouth from her new bottoms. Lord, I pray that you would just help her to continue to heal. And with the sores that she's having, and it just seems like she is getting better, but sometimes when you go through it, it doesn't seem like it because you're so close to it that... But she is doing so much better, and I just pray that you would continue to help her heal. You've answered so many prayers about that, Lord, and so I pray that you continue to bless her. Also, Lord, I just am so thankful that we're having another baptism today and that we have one more to give you, Lord, one more to be a part of your family, one more to be a testimony to the world. What a blessing it is to have baptisms, and I'm so proud of all of it, Lord. So we thank you again. Lord, we just turn this service over to you, and we just ask for a blessing on everybody that's here. Let them be touched by your Spirit. Let them feel that joy that comes from knowing you, and help them to know that security that comes from trusting you. So, Lord, I just pray that you would bless this service in a big way as we turn it over to you. We ask for all of these things, Lord, again, in your precious name we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. Praise God. Thank you for praying with me. Right now, can we have our ushers come forward today? I guess. We're going to sing a hymn right now, and it is an old hymn. It's Crown Him with Many Crowns. It'll take you way back to your childhood days, probably. Here we go.
I'm Thank you.
Testing, 1, 2. Well, okay, here we are. Here we are again. Now today we are talking about the judgment seat of Christ. And there is some ancillary scriptures that we have that goes along with the one that we're going to be at. And we are going to be in 1 Corinthians 3. 1 Corinthians 3, there's lots of places for the judgment seat of Christ, but this is the one I'm going to dwell on today. And so that's what we're going to be in. So that's 1 Corinthians 3. And I think about the judgment of God. And where's Don? I hear my competition. He said, wait a minute. Okay, he had to do something. I really. So I'll just stall. You think I can think of anything to say?
He's not up there.
Don's gone. We were talking about you, Don.
I heard.
Anyway, as we think about the judgment seat of Christ, I think about God's judgment. It kind of made me think of a story, which is, well, that's a first, isn't it? Yeah. There was a story about this young college student flying in a two-seater plane with just the pilot.
Thank you.
And then as they were flying along, all of a sudden, the pilot has a heart attack. And he dies. Oh, man, she's frantic. She grabs a mic and calls, Mayday, 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 help me, help me. My pilot had a heart attack and is dead, and I don't know how to fly. Somebody, please help me, please help me. And she hears a voice on the radio saying, hello, this is air traffic controller, and I have you loud and clear. And I will talk you through this and get you back on the ground. I've had a lot of experience with this kind of problem. Now just take a deep breath, stay calm, and everything is going to be fine. Now give me your height and your position. And she said, well, I'm 5'4 and I support Hillary. He said, okay. And the voice on the radio said, repeat after me, our Father who art in heaven. Well, I got that from one of my relatives, believe it or not.
I believe that.
I married into a family that has some of those jokes, you know, Uncle Kim. Let's start off with a word of prayer here before we get into our studies here. Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you so much that we can come together and pray, Lord. We have so much to be thankful for, like I say, Lord. We definitely want to hold a couple others up that we didn't hold up, Lord. I pray that you would just bless Bruce and Melinda. I think Bruce might be struggling a little bit more than we think, and he's been having some heart issues, and so, Lord, I just pray that you would just bless them, comfort them, and heal them, Lord, and just help them. I miss them when they're gone. So, Lord, just bless them in a big way. Also, Lord, we want to hold up Lee and Shar. Shar is here today. Lee had to work, but they're leaving on Wednesday to go back east to visit relatives, and they're going to be gone for 2 weeks. So, Lord, I just want to hold them up and pray for safe travels for them and just let them have a glorious, wonderful time. They're just super wonderful people, full of Christ. And I just pray that you would just help them be a testimony wherever they go and keep a hedge of protection around them as they go. And just bless them really good with joy for the whole trip, Lord. And we just thank you again. Lord, I just pray that you would open the hearts and minds and eyes and ears of everybody here to receive a message today and seal it to their hearts, Lord, and help them have a little bit better understanding as we explore doctrine in your word and we understand you more, Lord. Help us to grow and let that character be built, that we might be the people that you want us to be, that we have something to look forward to when we get to heaven, and that we're not wondering what it's going to be like as much as that we'll just know that Christ will be there and we'll be excited to see him. Help us to understand more about this whole situation. We turn it over to you right now and ask for these things. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Amen. The judgment seat of Christ. Now there are three judgments on your outline. We're going to get started on it right off the bat that we all must face. God judges us as sinners on your outline there today. And then God judges us as sons and daughters on your outline. And then God judges us as servants on your outline. So first, how does God judge us as sinners? Well, if we are sinners, then we stand before the great white throne judgment after the 1,000-year period and are judged according to, on your outline, our works. then you'll be judged for your works. However, we know that we've all sinned and come short of the glory of God, and the wages of sin is death, and the soul that sinneth shall surely die. And sinners stand there before the great white throne at the end of time and are judged and then cast into hell, all of them. You say, wait a minute, Pastor, are you saying that I'm going to be judged and cast into hell? Well, no, not if you're saved. Because if you're saved, for you, that judgment has already passed. And you say, well, when did the judgment take place? Well, listen, it was when Christ died in your place on Mount Moriah. You see, Christ died in your place, and because Jesus suffered and bled and died on the cross, Christ took your judgment for you at, on your outline, Calvary. Calvary is where we were judged as sinners. For the Bible says in Romans 5:1, for therefore now there is no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. So no judgment for you because you have settled out of court. You have a Savior that's paid for your sin. And we know that all sin will be pardoned in Christ or punished in hell, because no sin will go unjudged. No sin will go unjudged. Now there's the judgment as sinners. If you're saved, that judgment is behind you. And then there's the judgment as sons and daughters. So if you are a son or a daughter of God, you are saved and secure. But if you yet fully and deliberately sin, he has to, on your outline, chastise you. Now that's not a judgment to see whether you're saved or lost. You see, that has already been settled and stuff, because you can never again be a lost soul if you are truly saved. But who the Lord loves, he chastises. He scourges every son that he receiveth. And if God deals with you as a son, and you disobey him, and you live in sin openly, willingly, and deliberately, do you know what he'll do to you? He will carry you to the woodshed, and he has a variety of different methods to do just that. That's what he'll do. And not because he doesn't love you. It's because he does love you. So God judges us as sinners, and again, there at Calvary. But then again, we see God judges us as sons, and that's chastisement. And then one day, thirdly, God is going to judge us as servants. We are saved to serve. And one day, the way that we serve the Lord is going to be brought into review. Now, this judgment as servants is called, on your outline, the judgment seat of Christ. This is how we will be judged when we go there. We're not going to be judged whether we're sinners or not. We got saved under the blood, but now we're going to be saved for what we've been doing after we got saved. And did you know that there are many Christians that say, I'm saved, judgment is behind me, but oh no, listen church, one of these days you are going to stand before the judgment seat of Christ, and the way that you have served is what's going to come into review. And don't think that it's not make any difference, because it will. Let me read you a scripture here. I'm going to turn to 1 Corinthians 3, we're already there, 11, from 11 to 16. Here we go, read with me, follow along. For other foundation can no man lay than that is laid, which is Jesus Christ. He's the foundation. Now, if any man build upon this foundation, gold, silver, precious stones, wood, hay, stubble, every man's work shall be made manifest. That means it'll be made known, for the day shall declare it. It'll be obvious, because it shall be revealed by fire, and the fire shall try every man's work of what sort it is. If any man's work abide, which he hath built thereupon, he shall receive a reward. If any man's work shall be burnt, he shall suffer loss. But if he himself shall be saved, yet so as by fire, know ye not that you are not the temple of God, and that the Spirit of God dwelleth in you? So here we see fire test every man's work, okay? Now let's think about what the Apostle Paul is talking about here right now. And he's saying, and he has this wonderful illustration, and he's saying that the church is a temple, but not a temple made of stone. It's not a temple made of stone or wood. I mean, not an earthly building. It is a spiritual temple. spiritual on your outline. It's a spiritual temple that we're talking about now. Likewise, we are the temple of God, not a temple of stone, but a temple of flesh and blood. Now, it's like this. In the Old Testament, God had a temple for his people, but in the New Testament, God has a people for his temple. Isn't that interesting how that dispensation switched everything around? Now, this spiritual temple has a foundation. I want to read it again in verse 11. For other foundation can no man lay than that is laid, which is Jesus Christ. So the foundation for this spiritual temple is Jesus Christ, and our lives are to be built upon that foundation, the foundation of Jesus Christ. And we are living stones in the temple. Look at verse 12. Now, if any man built upon this foundation gold, silver, and precious stones, wood, hay, and stubble. So here we have a variety of things. Right here, the Apostle Paul says they're folks now, that when they get saved, they come to Jesus Christ, and he is the foundation, and then they begin to build on their lives, and some of them build out of gold and silver or costly, precious stones, and that must be a beautiful temple. But of course, we're speaking about a spiritual temple. But others are building on wood, hay, and stubble, or straw. Kind of sounds like the three little pigs, doesn't it? They're building with wood, hay, and stubble. Now, what's the difference between that and gold and silver and precious stones? Well, first of all, precious stones and gold and silver, they don't burn. They don't burn. Wood, hay, and stubble, highly combustible, and it is not all that expensive. Now, when it comes to Christians, I don't know who's building with what. But God knows. God knows. And some of you out there are gold, silver, and precious stones, and some of you out there are wood, hay, and stubble builders. Really, I don't know. And actually, you don't know either who's who and who's doing what. However, there will come a day when it will be revealed, because God is going to give a test, and he's going to give what we call the torch test. And it's going to be a day that is going to be revealed, and it is coming, and the Lord will judge. Look what it says in 13, every man's work shall be made manifest, known, for the day shall declare it, because it shall be revealed by fire, and the fire shall try every man's work of what sort it is. Now, you can fool your pastor, and you can fool your wife, or you can fool your husband, but you cannot fool God. And one of these days, it is going to be made known, dear friends. I mean, whether your life is wood, hay, and stubble, or gold and silver and precious stones. Now, here's what he is talking about now, whether it is a spiritual people or a carnal people. Wood, hay, and stubble is carnal, and precious stones is spiritual. Are you walking in the light, or did you get saved and forget about everything? You know, this is the thing. And I tell you, most of the people in the average church, I hate to say, are carnal and fleshly, and it's sad. And that means most of them have been building on wood, hay, and stubble. And they're not gold, silver, precious stone Christians. And I tell you, the judgment day of Christ is going to come, and Christ is the foundation, and God is the building inspector, and he's going to put my life and your life to the test. And that is one day, and by the way, don't think that it's way out there younger. Listen, we're only a heartbeat away. We're all much closer to eternity than we realize, and we don't like to think about it. But the Bible says that there is but a step between me and death. And you say, well, hey, wait a minute, I'm in good health and stuff. But you could get hit by a truck. You could have an accident. You don't know how soon you're going to be reporting in to Christ and get judged. So it is very, very important, therefore, that we learn the lessons about what is going to happen when we're judged as servants. Now, let me mention some of the things here now about the judgment seat of Christ. First of all, the judgment seat of Christ will be a time of, on your outline, revelation. Revelation. Look what it says in verse 13 again. Every man's work shall be made manifest. Known. That's a revelation. For the day shall declare it. It'll be known, because it shall be revealed by fire, and the fire shall try every man's work of what sort it is. So it says we will be revealed by fire. Now God is going to show what kind of life we live. We are going to see it in that day from God's point of view, not your point of view. Now, a lot of things that people think are important today, God is not impressed with. You know, for example, I remember when Samuel was looking for a king to be the next king of Israel. This was after Saul flubbed up. They'd already picked Saul, which was a big mistake. God said, I never picked him. But this is after Saul loved up. And so he went to the sons of Jesse. And of course, Jesse is David's father. And they all stood up. He had a bunch of kids that they were looking at first. And first of all, the one man, he just looked like a king that prayed in front of Samuel. He was head and shoulders above all the others. He was handsome as could be. He was a kingly looking kind of fella. And he kind of sounded the description of Saul. And God said to Samuel, don't look at him like that. Don't look at his height. Don't look at his countenance, for I have refused him. And then God says, I don't see as man sees. Man looks at the outward appearance, but God looks at the heart. And listen, aren't you glad that God looks at the heart rather than the outward appearance? Praise the Lord. Some wouldn't do so well if God all measured us by how handsome or how beautifully or how stately we are. Jackie didn't marry me for my looks. She married me for my brains. And she said, it's the little things that matter. But what men applaud or what men look up to doesn't impress God. Beauty, brains, bucks, brawn, it doesn't impress God at all. Now, men impress one another, and you may become a movie star. You might become a beauty queen and stuff. But God says, I'm not impressed with all of that at all. You see, again, these are the words of Jesus. Look at what he says in Luke 16, 15. He says this, and he said unto them, you are they which justify yourselves before men, but God knoweth your hearts. For that which is highly esteemed amongst men is an abomination to the sight of God. You see, God looks at the heart, and one of these days at the judgment seat of Christ, our hearts are going to be made manifest. Our hearts are going to be, not our deeds and our works, but our hearts. Look what it says in 13 again. I've read it three times. Every man's work shall be made manifest, for the day shall declare it, because it shall be revealed by fire, and the fire shall try every man's work of what sort it is. Now notice, he doesn't say what size it is. He says what it is, or what sort it is. And you know what that is? That means the quality of it. So the fire tests everyone's works of what sort it is. Now, what he's saying is that quality is more important than quantity. And we as Americans get such a big emphasis on size. But be reasonable. Let me ask you a question. Which would you rather have, a truckload of hay or a handful of diamonds? And that's what he's saying. That's what he's trying to say, that wood, hay, and stubble. So the difference between hay or gold and silver and precious stones. And so we see that he's talking here about quality. Now, that's what he's trying to make out of you, quality. He doesn't want to make you an empty shell that got saved. He wants a person that he wants you to be, the kind of people he wants you to be. Yes. So he's looking for quality and character. You know, I heard about a girl that was dating a Texan, and she was hoping he was a rich Texan, and she was trying to find exactly about how much he had. She said, you got any cattle and stuff? And he says, yeah, I got some cattle. And she goes, well, how much? And he goes, well, I got almost 50 head. And she thought, well, okay. Well, do you have any oil wells? And he says, yes, I do. I got two of them. And she thought, well, that didn't really satisfy her either and stuff. Well, do you have any land? And he goes, well, I have almost 100 acres. Well, that wasn't very impressive either until he said, in downtown Dallas. Whoa. So you see, quality that counts. Now, God is not looking for quantity. And we get so busy sometimes that we go around, running around, knocking things over, and think that we're impressive God when we're not. How is God going to find the difference then? Well, how is he going to judge the difference between sort and size and like what sort it is and all that? Well, I'm going to give you 3 points right now that God is going to use as a standard on your outline between sort and size. Number one, God is going to judge us when we come to the judgment seat of Christ. Number one, by our attitude. Our attitude. Not only what we did, but why we did it. Now look at the key verse. I'm going to look ahead here. Look at 1 Corinthians 9:16. You don't have to, Donald, go there. For though I preach the gospel, I have nothing to glory of, for necessity is laid upon me. Yea, woe is unto me if I preach not the gospel. Well, now, if God has called you to preach, listen, you can't do anything else but preach. I know for a fact. You can't get out of it. And, you know, woe is me if I do not preach the gospel, and with a joyful heart. Look what the next verse says in verse 17. It says, for if I do this thing willingly, I have a reward. But if against my will, a dispensation of the gospel is committed unto me. Now, you see, what he's saying is if God has called me to preach, I can't get out of it. It's like Jonah. Jonah goes, I don't want to go tell those Ninevites, those crappy old, excuse my French, those terrible Assyrians that were killing all these people and pinning them up all over, and they were so mean to the Jerusalem. He goes, I don't want to go preach to them. I don't want to. So he ran away. And so what did God do? He had a whale swallow him. Till finally he went back and goes, okay, God, you know what's best. And so this is what happens when God has called you to do something, especially in his service. And he said, I want you to do what you do willingly and not grudgingly and out of necessity, not because you have to. See, God doesn't need me. He just wants my heart. He wants me. God doesn't need me. I've already done that. I've pulled power plays on God going, well, they're not going to do this, God, then I'm not going to do this. And you know, God showed me, he don't need me. You're out. So I know where my bread's buttered, and this is so important that we submit to the Lord. And God is going to judge us at the judgment seat of Christ for our ministry and our service, and not only for what we did, but did we do it willingly and gladly with a free heart, which is what he wants us to have. Willingly and gladly with a free heart. You know, sometimes people are forced into service. I mean, they have to preach and they don't want, or they have to sing or have to be in the choir, or they have to be on the nursery, or they have to take care of the youth, or they have to work on the grounds or whatever, because they say, well, somebody's got to do it. And that's why we do it. And that's the way they serve. And I mean, rather than doing it with joy and gladness, saying, Lord Jesus, thank you for this privilege to let me use what I know. And thank you for the privilege to be able to serve you. And you know, sometimes people serve and they do it just to be seen of men. They do that just to kind of show off. And you know, Jesus spoke of those who stood on the street corner and prayed to be seen of men. And you know what he said? Verily, verily, they have their reward. What is the reward? It's to be seen of men, and that's it. That's as far as it goes. You get your reward here on earth. I remember a guy that used to compliment. I said, stop complimenting. You're taking my rewards away. That's kind of cute, and of course, that won't take him away, but we see that it is important to do things with a happy heart and stuff. So that's it. That's as far as it goes. Jesus said, sometimes when people give, they go and they blow the trumpet, and then they take their gift and go, hey, everybody, look what I'm giving. And God says, verily, they have the reward. And what is the reward? It's just to be seen of men. Popularity is a pretty good reward here on earth, but it is not what God is looking for. God is going to look at us, and when we come to the judgment seat of Christ, and listen, because I want to make it abundantly clear that the judgment seat of Christ has nothing to do whether you're saved or lost. Because remember, we said once you're saved, it's you are going to heaven, and that is settled. And he is going to judge us according to, first of all, our attitude on the things. And I mean not only what we did, but why we did it. Secondly, on your outline, he's going to judge us by this. Number two, by our authority. By our authority. By authority. So did you have the authority from heaven to do what you did? That is, are you serving God according to the word of God? Because it has to line up. Does your ministry have heaven's authority behind it? Because it has to line up with the word of God. You know, some people are doing things that God never even commissioned. God never asked. God never wanted. And they think they're doing God a big favor for doing it. But God never asked for that. Listen to this scripture in 2 Timothy 2:5. If a man also strive for masteries, yet he's not crowned except he strive lawfully. What does that mean? Masteries, he's talking about an athletic contest. Let me explain. If you were running in the Olympics in the day, you wanted to get that laurel, or you wanted to get that crown, or you wanted to get that reward or that recognition. Listen, if you want that, you can't cut across the track. You can't cut across the field. You have to stay in the track. You have to stay in your lane. You can't break the rules. That's like Lance Armstrong. He might have won. But since he didn't do it the right way, they took the crown away. That's what it's like. And God has given us a rule book so we would know. And you have to ask yourself the question, does my ministry have the authority of God behind it? Now let me give you an example of this. There was a man in the Old Testament and his name was Saul. We were talking about him. Saul was the king over Israel. And God said to Saul through Samuel, Saul, I want you to go to battle against these people, and the name of the people were the Amalekites, and we've talked about them a million times. They were bad. They were unspeakably immoral. And God said, I want you to destroy them, and I want you to destroy all of their flocks and all their herds and put them all to death. Of course, one of those Amalekites came back and killed Saul because he didn't do it. They were very immoral. They had sexual diseases. They had all kinds of things, and God wanted them out of the land. They were the ones that picked on Moses coming through the land and everything, and so God had it out for them, and he wanted Saul to be his man to get rid of them so the Jews could have their land. And God said, I want you to destroy them. I want you to destroy all their flocks, all their herds, and put them all to death. And Samuel came to Saul and said, Saul, did you do what I told you to do? And he said, oh, yeah, I did. Saul, did you do it? Yeah, exactly what you told me to do. Samuel said, well, did you kill the animals too, like God said? Yes, I did. And Samuel said, well, what's the lowing of the sheep that I hear? He said, what's the lowing of the oxen and the bleating of the sheep? And Saul's going, well, I saved some of them. I saved the best to sacrifice to the Lord, which is a fat offering to the Lord. And he said, and then I was going to use it to feed my men. And Samuel said, you didn't obey. To obey is better than to sacrifice, than to hearken, than the fat of rams. And that is, Saul, I don't want your service unless you have my authority behind it. You have to do it like God says to do it. And that's what God is saying, and it's all about obedience. And when we come to the judgment seat of Christ, we have to do things God's way, not our way. And that's how we're going to be judged. So first of all, we're talking about our attitude, not only what we did, but why we did it. And next, number two, our authority. Did we have the authority of Almighty God behind it? Are we serving according to the Word of God? And next, number three, we are going to be judged according to, on your outline, our ability. Our ability. Now, God is going to require more from some people than he does other people, because some people have more abilities than others. And here's the operative verse. I want you to look at Luke 12, 48. It says this. But he that knew not and did commit things worthy of stripes being whipped shall be beaten with few stripes, because he didn't know. For unto whomsoever much is given, of him shall be much required. And to whom men have committed much, of him they will ask the more. So if you've been given much, God requires more out of you. That's scary as we grow in the Lord. But what a blessing it is from the obedience. But he does require more. It's scary to be a teacher of a preacher of God. You're held to a higher esteem. And when you teach wrong things, you can get in a lot of trouble. That's why when our leaders are wrong, they need to be held to a higher standard. God is going to test you, not according to somebody else's ability either. He's not looking to somebody else. I can't say, well, gee, Lord, I was better. No, he's going to look at me according to my own ability is what he's going to be thinking about. And so many of us, we have a way of measuring ourselves by other people. For example, some can give more than others. You see, God does not measure a gift primarily by the amount that's on the face of the check, but by the balance on the check. That's what he's looking at. Nobody knows that but you and him, you and God. You know, Jesus went to the worship service one day, and Jesus stood by and watched what the people are putting in the treasury. And by the way, that's kind of interesting too. Remember that every time the offering is taken, Jesus knows what we give, doesn't he? He knows what we give. Now, Jesus saw there this little widow, and she didn't have any Social Security or any annulment, which is, you know, people taking care of her or anything. And Jesus just watched that little widow, and she came, and she perhaps unwrapped her little handkerchief and got out the widow's mite, and it was all she had, and it was less than a penny, and she just didn't have anything else, and it was just that she had between starvation and her. And she's putting it in the offering anyway. But she's even ashamed because she doesn't have that much. And here she is with a little shawl around her, maybe bent over with osteoporosis or something. Here's this little widow, and she put her offering in. And you know what Jesus had to say? He said this. Jesus said, she gave more than all of them. He didn't say she gave more than any of them. He said she gave more than all of them. Well, what did she do? Listen, she gave according to her ability. God compares what you give to what you have. Now, let me ask this question. Is there anybody here that can't do what you can do? God is not asking you to do what you can't do. God is asking you to do what you can do. It reminds me of Mary when she took that box of alabaster ointment and she broke it and lavished the feet of Jesus with that sweet perfume and took that long black silken hair of hers and she wiped his feet. And there were those who were criticizing and Jesus said, let her alone. She's doing what she could do. So you see, God is not asking you to do what somebody else can do. That wouldn't be fair. God is asking you to do what you can do. And Jesus said she has done what she could do. And saints, again, you can't outgive God. You'll never give too much. Now, if she can, she can. So don't tell me you can't serve the Lord. If there's anybody here that can't do what they can do, if you can, I want you to lift your hand so I can laugh at you. Because you can do what you can do. And that's all that Jesus asks of the people, to do what they can do. He doesn't ask you to do what other people can do. He doesn't ask that. And that's why we're going to be tested. We're going to be rewarded according to our ability. And when God brings you to the judgment seat of Christ, he's just going to ask, are you using what you have? So we never want to go around comparing ourselves with somebody else or to somebody else. And don't lord over anybody else because you think that you're hot, because I'll tell you right now, you're not. And the Bible asks, what do you have that you haven't received from God? All good things come from God. Took me a while to understand that. Took me years to understand that all good things come from God. But now I see how he has his hand in everything and how he has control of everything. Things I didn't understand, and he's there everywhere, constantly, and especially when you cry out to him and talk to him. He is there. He won't let you down. You know, it reminds me of a story about years ago, there was a mother who was sick in the hospital, and she had a Down syndrome child. It was limited in intellectual ability, but she was such a precious little girl, and they loved her so much. Now, the other children made high grades in school, but this little girl, of course, was limited and challenged. Now, a time came in the hospital when all the other children thoughtfully bought some flowers in the lobby to take to their mother there in the hospital. And somehow, they overlooked this little girl. Well, she saw that they all had flowers, this little girl. And then she looked outside. And she saw out there in the front of the hospital, there was some grass growing. But really, it was kind of like it was just really a bunch of weeds. And she brought them. She went out and picked them and got the handful of weeds, and she brought them into the hospital room. Now, the other children had presented their flowers to their mother, and she just loved them. And then this precious little girl went up and hugged her mother and gave that mother the handful of weeds. I want to ask every mother that is here today, what do you think that mother did? Do you think that mother said, well, darling, those are just weeds. Mama don't want those. No, you don't know a mother's heart if you could say that. I tell you, she took that precious baby and wrapped her arms around her and said, darling, thank you. Thank you so much for the wonderful gift that you brought to Mommy. Mommy loves you. Now, friends, I want to tell you that you may not have all the ability that you think that you need, but you might come to God as if it were with a handful of weeds. But God is going to look at your heart. He's going to look at your heart just like that little girl, and God is not going to compare you to somebody else. God is going to test your work of what sort it is, and it's not how big it is. And I tell you, God's going to look at your attitude. Your attitude, and you see, it's not just what you did, but why you did it. And then God's going to look at your authority. Were you obeying him and doing what you were told to do and doing it in the way that he told you to do it? Because to obey is better than sacrifice. Remember, obedience brings joy. And also, God is going to look at your ability. Did you serve him according to what he gave you? You know, one of these days I'm going to give an account for my abilities that God has given me, good or bad. And likewise for you, you will be giving an account of what you did with your abilities. And when we get to heaven, there's going to be some people that receive a bigger reward than some of the big shots. I just know it. And I tell you, it'll take another world to show some of those who all those big creatures really are, and I mean for God, for real, in the kingdom of heaven. And you know, today day, so many go, wow, there's so-and-so. He's got that big church and everything. But in my estimation, some of the greatest preachers are some in crossroads, cross towns, overworked, underpaid, and God knows their name. And one of these days, some of those will, in the limelight, so forth, maybe way down the line when that day comes, all the way back behind some of those who have been serving God diligently, ones who have been unknown, unsung, unwept, and unhonored, folks that are ministering in small places, just ordinary people with just a few in their congregation, people that have been faithful to the Lord. God judges by the heart. He judges by the heart. You see, things are going to look a lot different when they're seen in the white, bright light of eternity. God doesn't see as man sees. Man looks at the outward appearances, but God looks in the heart. I was thinking about that. I was out preparing the message. And you see, ultimately, it's going to be a time of revelation. Things will be revealed by fire. And then secondly, the judgment seat of Christ is going to be a time on your outline of reward. You see, here on earth, you're making your treasures in heaven. That's your rewards. Treasures in heaven is bringing people to the Lord, you know, sharing the ministry, the Great Commission. Look what it says in 1 Corinthians 3:14. If any man's work abide, which he hath built thereupon, he shall receive a reward. Now he's talking about building on Jesus. Now we know wood, hay, and stubble or straw are not going to abide when the torch test comes, because wood, hay, and stubble are going to go up in flames. But listen, gold and silver and precious stones have already been through the fire. It says they will abide. So ultimately, if any man's work is going to last, I mean, if it abides, he's going to receive a reward. And that's a promise. Look what it says in verse 8. Now he that planteth and he that watereth are one. And every man shall receive his own reward according to his own labor. Think about that. Sometimes people will share the seed like Johnny Appleseed, and people will come to church and I'll share the light and it'll help bring them to the Lord. And the Holy Spirit is what makes that person finally accept the Lord. Not me, not the person throwing out the seed, but it requires us to do our job, and that is treasures in heaven. That will be our rewards. So we see a reward according to his own labor. Look at it says in verse 14 again. If any man's work abide, which he hath built thereupon, he shall receive a reward. Now, did you know that the Bible said that there is going to be rewards in heaven for real? And you know that people just think, many of them, this. They think, well, we're all going to be in the same place. We're all going to go to heaven, and that God's an equal opportunity God. And they think that God would be kind of un-American if he didn't pay us all the same. But there are levels of love, I believe. God evaluates us by our own. And there are rewards in heaven. Heaven will not be the same for everybody. The Bible is clear about that. Now, I know that that gets the hackles of some people, especially carnal people, because they love to think about those old songs like, just build me a castle in the corner of Glory Land, and it'll all be fine up there, preacher, any way you slice it. I just want to get to heaven, and it'll all be all right. But friend, I want to tell you something, that this matter of rewards is taught in the Bible very clearly. It's right here in these passages that I just read to you, the back passages, verses 8 and verse 14. And let me give you another verse. I'll turn to Revelation 14, 13. I want to show you something here. In 13 it says, and I heard a voice from heaven saying unto me, write, blessed are the dead which die in the Lord from henceforth. Oh, we're in the tribulation here now. Yea, saith the Spirit, that they may rest from their labors. Okay, we know that happens when you go there. And their works do follow them. Follow them. Works never bring you to heaven. You can't get to heaven by good works. Good people can't go to heaven. Only saved people. And if you go to heaven because you're saved, your good works follow you to heaven, and you will be rewarded accordingly. Works never bring you to heaven. They are not saved by good works, not at all. It's not of works, lest any man should boast. That was the answer. If you could do it by works, we'd have boasters. Man doesn't have pride, does he? Oh, yeah, we'd be boasters and stuff. So when you go to heaven, what you've done will follow you to heaven. Look what it says in Revelation 22:12, moving way up toward the back of the book. And behold, I come quickly, which means, and when he comes, he'll come in an instant, quickly. And my reward is with me to give every man according as his work shall be. Well, let me give you a verse that talks about rewards in heaven. Listen to this. It's Matthew 6:20. Remember it. We've read it a million times. But lay up yourself treasures in heaven where neither moth nor rust doth corrupt and where thieves do not break through nor steal. So Jesus said, lay up yourself treasures in heaven. Now, friends, it makes absolutely no sense, none whatsoever at all, if we all get the same amount of treasure in heaven. It wouldn't make any sense. Lay up yourself treasures in heaven tells us that it's going to be a time of rewards. Now, thirdly, not only is the judgment seat of Christ a time of revelation where works are revealed by fire, which is the day, it will be the time of reward to declare it. Not only will it be a time of reward also, but I want to tell you, saints, and listen very carefully, church, because thirdly, for some on your outline, it will be a time of regret. Regret when the saints get to heaven. Look what it says in verse 15. It says in Corinthians, 1 Corinthians 15, if any man's work shall be burnt, he shall suffer loss, but he himself shall be saved, yet so as by fire. Well, what does that mean? If any man's work shall be burned, he shall suffer loss. What does that mean? Here's a Christian, and he gives his heart to Jesus. He's truly saved because he has the foundation. And like it says in 1 Corinthians 3:11, that no other foundation, no man laid, that is laid, which is Jesus Christ. So Jesus is the foundation, that no one can lay any foundation other than the one that's already laid. Of course, that's Jesus. So this man has come, and he has put his faith in Jesus. He's trusting Jesus. He lives his selfish life, a casual life, a prideful life, a self-centered life, and he's out for self and self alone, but he believes in Jesus. However, his life is characterized by wood, hay, and straw, stubble. You all know carnal Christians. We all know some carnal Christians. But then comes the judgment seat, and then comes the fire that will test and tries, and the wood and the hay and the straw, it all goes up in flames. Well, is he going to heaven? Yeah, he'll go to heaven. Why? Because of the foundation. You see, the foundation remains. The foundation doesn't burn. And if any man's work should be burned, which he has built upon, he shall suffer loss, even though he himself shall be saved. And so as by fire he is saved, but singed, he's singed. He gets to heaven with his coattails smoking. Now listen, the things that are burned, I tell you that they are things that are important to him. Carnal Christian things are important to them. We say that's not important in heaven, but they're important to me now. I'll worry about heaven later. These things are important to me. And when all his life goes up in flames, he faces a tragic loss. And he will have regrets, it says. Listen to this scripture that points this out in 1 John 2:28. 1 John 2:28, it says this. And now, little children, abide in him, that when he shall appear, he may have confidence and not be ashamed before him at his coming. Now, what he calls us little children, and that's like the children of Israel. He doesn't mean like boys and girls. He means children of God, which in the Bible is ones who are abiding in him. Now, listen to me. If Jesus were to come right now, we heard a voice saying, behold, the bridegroom cometh. Come out and meet him. We're going up. Would you be ready? Would you? Saying, oh, thank you, Lord. We're going to go be with the Lord right now. You're going to be disappearing right now. You say, well, would you be ready? Are you really ready? Or would you say, oh, no, 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 not yet. I'm not quite ready to meet you, Lord. I'm saved, but I'm not quite ready to go yet. You know, it makes me think about when I was a little kid. My dad used to work late, and I used to look forward to him coming home. Most times, that is. But there were times when I'd be out playing, and my dad would come home, and I would do either one of two things. When my dad would come home, I would run out and hug him, and he would be excited to see me, and I'd be excited, and I would... But then there was other times when I would head off to the bushes because I didn't want to see him. And you know, it would all depend on what my behavior had been. I was pretty much perfect, but every once in a great while, I might have strayed away from my perfect self. You know? And you know, it would all depend on what my behavior had been. And it would all depend on basically what my mom would tell him when he got home. You see, it would all depend on obedience. And if I would have done the chores or the things that Dad told me that I was supposed to do. And friend, it's the same way when Jesus comes. Don't you want to be excited to see him because you did this for him and this for him and this for him? You go, oh, I can't wait to see you because I did these things. And if you didn't do anything, you're going to be going, well, I don't really know Jesus. I suppose it'll be good up there. I don't know what it's like to be around him, but I suppose it'll be okay. You got to get in gear, you know. You're in the service now. It would depend on the obedience, on the chores and things. We need to be excited. Did you do the things that you were told to do? Did you find out his will? Where you say, Lord Jesus, I am so glad to see you. And that's what we're talking about. When you abide in him, you're going to have fruit and you're going to have rewards. And that's why it brings joy, because you can't wait to see him. Woo! Praise the Lord. Abide in him so that when he shall appear, you will have confidence and not be ashamed at him at his coming. I hear Christians that are kind of promiscuous. And I don't want to get the Bobby Prize Award when I get there. I don't want to kind of go through, cross the line and have them go, whoo, we were wondering if you were going to make it or not. Or I get the Scallywag Prize or something when I get to heaven. I don't want that. I don't want that. Look what it says in Matthew 5:19. This is what Jesus said. Matthew 5:19, it says, whosoever therefore shall break one of these least commandments and shall teach men so, he shall be called the least in the kingdom of heaven. But whosoever shall do and teach them the same shall be called great in the kingdom of heaven. And so what we're saying is that you're not going, it's not that you're not going to heaven, but he says you're going to be the least. But whosoever shall do and teach them the same, that is, do and teach his commandments, they shall be called great in the kingdom of heaven. Now, we know some people that are saved kind of Christians, but their doctrine is so off. And we know it's just weird because it seems like he loves Jesus. And we can't figure out how he's coming up with this other doctrine. We'll believe him by fire, or God will let us know. And those that are teaching the wrong thing by not following the will of God, or by following the word of God, or by following things that are politically correct and make a bigger church, will be called the least in the kingdom of heaven. Look what it says in 2 John 8. Here, 2 John 8. It says that, look to yourselves that we lose not those things which we have wrought, but that we receive a full reward. A full reward. Do you want a full reward when Jesus comes? You don't want to be disqualified for one reason or another, or lose some points because of how you did it. Look what it says in Revelation 3:11. It says this. It says, behold, I come quickly. Hold that fast which thou hast, that no man take thy crown. Don't be swayed by people. Because there's coming today, surely as I'm standing here, and I don't understand all about it, but it's coming. And you